Well, let me relieve some of your wondering right off the gate until you turn to Leviticus chapter 1. If you're not up with us in the reading, then you have no idea why I would say it that way. But if you are, and you this morning got up and read Leviticus 13, 14, and 15, welcome to the awkward chapters. We're not done with them. Skin diseases, rashes, and other more delicate subjects, none of which are my focus today. Can we all say thank you, Jesus? But then I was thinking about, you're reading that, and I taught this a while back on Wednesday night. One of the things that you can pull out of all of the awkwardness and what would seem odd to us at how just open and upfront God is about certain issues and situations and ailments and physical issues that we deal. I'm trying to find an easy way to say this, and I'm struggling. That in a time like today, when we're dealing with flu in the numbers that we are, if you will just listen to the wisdom of God, when he talks about there are times when you need to isolate yourself and purify yourself before you get back out in public, then we would be a lot better off today, wouldn't we? Amen. God knows what he's dealing with. He knows what he's talking about. So let me go on to what I'm going to focus on today. The Old Testament shows us the importance of worship. In fact, as you press through the last half of the book of Exodus and the book of Leviticus and on into Numbers and Deuteronomy, and you read again and again the detailed instructions God gives them about the process of building and preparing and setting up the house of worship, the directions that God gives them about the actions and elements that are involved in them practicing their faith, in their expression of their worship to God. All of that, all that you've been pressing through for a few days and are right now and will continue for another week or two, bring us into this realization, the chapters, the verses, the measurements, the descriptions, the details, they show you how much worship was a life focus and was to be a life focus for the people of God. Not just a part of their life. But I think when you read the Old Testament, God shows you that his desire was to have a nation of people for whom worship was to be more than a part of their life, but was to be the central focus of their life. They were raised up to be a worshiping people walking in covenant with God. And everything about their lives flowed from the worship of their lives. Everything about how they lived their day-to-day life was to be connected to and affected by the worship dynamic of their life. It wasn't something they just did one day a week for a couple of hours out of that day. It was a dynamic that affected who they were and was to affect how they lived in the day-to-day living out of their life. So I'll put it this way. They were a nation of worshipers of God that were raising up generations of worshipers. They were called to be a nation of worshipers so that the young ones would grow up in the midst of a nation of worshipers, and they would, in their worship and through their worship and by the example of their worship, raise up generations of those who would say, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." So there was this voice of the nation, the people of God, that began crying out in the wilderness place and continued shouting out from the land of their promise and lifted high the sounds and shouts and emotions and expressions, the spirit of their worship before their God. Worship was the focus of their life. Now, the Old Testament word that is used pertaining to worshiping God is always, it struck me, when you study worshiping God, the word worship as it connects to God is always the same word. It's the word shaka, and it means to bow yourself down, to fall down flat, to humbly beseech, to do reverence, to make stoop, and in that position of humbling ourselves before God, to lift up worship and honor and praise to the Lord. Now, I've told you already in this focus, in this study that we've been in, that one of the dynamics of blessing is that you lower yourself in order to lift up another. You humble yourself in order to exalt another. That's the spirit that you see and the posture that you see and the attitude that you see always as it pertains to our worshiping God. Worshiping God is an act of lowering ourselves or humbling ourselves so that we would reverence him and honor him and exalt and lift up and glorify the name of the Lord our God. When you look at worship, you understand about worship that it's both personal and enjoined. That it's both something that you do on an individual level, but it's something that we're called to do corporately as the people of God. I have to say it this way. This doesn't substitute for your personal worship. And nobody in this room can worship for you. There's a unique sound and expression and spirit of your worship that only you can lift up to God. It is personal. It is individual. And yet God calls us individually as worshipers to come together as the people of God and lift up our voice as one and lift up his praise as the people of God so that I, as a worshiper of God, come together with the people of God and together we say, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. We are a nation of worshipers of God. And it's interesting that having processed Exodus and the description and preparation of the house of worship, and then finding yourself in Exodus 40. And if you weren't with us Wednesday night, go back and watch that video where I talked to you about how the preparation that they embraced prepared them for the presence of God. So you finish Exodus and all the glory of the Lord, and it's like, whoo, the glory of the Lord filled the house. And then you open Leviticus. And interwoven into the fabric of the corporate part of our worship comes this realization that giving, that presenting an offering of worship is an undeniable and unavoidable dynamic of the true worship of true worshipers. You can't worship without giving. You cannot worship without giving. It is the dynamic of giving. Pastor Chase said it a while ago. You got to open your mouth. You got to give out a word. You got to breathe out a spirit of worship. You got to speak out a praise unto the Lord. You got to let your emotions come up out of you and be a part of the expression of your worship and your praise to God. There is this undeniable connection that if you're going to be a true worshiper, you're also going to be a giver. So what you begin as you open up the book of Leviticus and read the first several chapters, seven, in fact, I believe it is, what you read over and 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 over is about the offering dynamic of their worship. Listen to it. Leviticus 1, 1 and 2. The Lord called to Moses from the tabernacle and said to him, give the following instructions to the people of Israel. When you present an animal as an offering to the Lord. Now I'm going to just stop right there and I'm going to talk to you about the dynamic of the offering, but I'm not going to, and you can thank me later, go through all the details of all of those offerings that they were to give. although I will just interject right here, and I know some of you are in small groups, and praise God for that, and I hope you're connecting in there and growing through the Word of God. If you're not, come here tonight, and I'm going to show you one of those offerings, and I'm going to show you how you could look at every one of the five major offerings of the book of Leviticus. I'm not going to cover five, thank you, Lord. I'm going to cover one, but I'm going to show you through that one that you can walk through every one of them, and it's all Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It was all fulfilled through Jesus. So if you have that kind of, and if you're not connected somewhere else tonight, come here tonight. We'll get you done in time for some stupid game that nobody really cares about just because of who's playing. But so you can eat all those snacks that you bought. That celery and carrots and in the book of Leviticus and Numbers, the word offering is used in the New King James 556 times. So if you felt like you've been reading it a lot, you have, and you're going to keep on. In the New Living Translation, it's 451 times. Now, the difference is some of the times in New Living Translation, it talks about sacrifice, where in the New King James, it almost always uses the word offering. Now, the offerings that they brought, thank God, looked way different than the offerings that we bring today. But from them, there are these principles that flow out of them presenting their offerings to God that teach us spiritual principles in the offering. That's my focus today. Spiritual principles that I want you to draw out of this dynamic of the offering. And again, we're very thankful that you didn't have to come to church today carrying jars of grain and bottles of oil and containers of incense, dragging along behind you a sheep or a ram or a bull or toting turtle doves or pigeons or some goat. Well, some of you brought a lot of bull and an old goat with you. But bless God, you ain't leaving it here for me and Chase to have to deal with, and Ahmad and Thad. We don't want your old goat, ain't that right? Thankfully today, our offerings are different. But the concept, the heart from which our giving flows and is to flow, the spiritual principles of giving that flow through this worship of giving will speak to us out of Leviticus into where we are in our life. So what I want you to understand is my prayer about today has been this. Through today, you're going to begin to understand the importance and the value of the offering so that you won't let the time of giving in worship, of giving as an act of worship, of giving the tithe and the offering into the house of God as part of your worship. You won't let it pass you by, because you'll begin to understand that there are spiritual stirrings that happen through and because of our giving in worship. So you ready? Well, about six of you are. It's going to be teachy-preachy. So here we go. See, what I want you to understand is that through the giving of your tithes and your offering, while as we give that way, we understand that that's a process God set in place for the body of Christ to supply the need of the house of God and the ministry of the Lord. That need should never be your only or even your greatest reason to give. You shouldn't just be giving because the church needs you to give. Does the church need you to give? Yes. Do ministries need you to give to them? Yes. But through the worship of giving, what you are doing is making room for God's blessings by aligning your life with the spiritual principles that connect to the action and the spirit of your giving. So these principles really answer the question, why give? Why should I give? Why should I give the tithe in worship? Why should I give of my time in worship to God? Why should I use the talent that I have for the kingdom of God and for the glory of God? Why should I give? Now, when you read the word offering in Numbers and Leviticus, what you wouldn't automatically see is that that one word offering flows out of 17 different Hebrew words. Now, I got some more good news for you. I don't have 17 points in my sermon today. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. But I do want to show you some important principles from some of those words. Principles of giving in worship and principles of how you unlock the promises of God, that you encounter the presence of God, and you see God move in your life because you align yourself in the power of the principles of God. Again, I'm going to refer to Wednesday night. I don't have time to teach it, but you ought to go back, because one of the things that I talk about that's important is this realization that God set in place order and structure for his kingdom and for his people. And if you're going to walk in his blessing, you got to get your life aligned with what God has laid out. Ain't no God bless me where I am like I am because I don't want to be different than I am. It's here's how God set this up and ordained it and ordered it. And if we want to walk in what he has for us, we got to be willing to walk in what he wants of us. So there's this family of words that when you translate them into offering, they point to the relationship dynamic that's involved in our giving in worship to the Lord. The relationship between the person offering the gift and the relationship between them and God to whom it is that we are giving. So you have words like this. You have the word minka, which focuses on the fact that the offering is a portion that already belongs to God. Get this. Everything you give to God is already God's. God made it very clear to Israel that the offerings that they were being called to bring to him belonged to God before they ever gave them in worship to their God. It's already his. I'm gonna make you say that. Look at your neighbor. I know people hate when you do this, but here's a reason you need to do this. Because your memory, your retention is increased when you see it on the screen, when you speak it out, when you read it, greatly beyond. So look at your neighbor and say, it's already his. Everything you would use, every talent you would, every song you would sing, every ministry you would embrace, everything that you would do to God, every penny that you would give, it is God's before you ever offered it to him. They were bringing to God his portion of their blessing and their increase and the goodness that God poured into their life. So you see this specifically in places like the tithe. The Bible says the tithe belongs to God. Leviticus 27:30. Here's what it says. 1/10 of the produce of the land, whether grain from the fields or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord and must be set apart to him as holy. So if you're one of those people that have been saying, well, I pay my tithes. No, you're wrong. When you tithe, you are bringing to God what already belongs to him. You're not paying your tithe, you're bringing his tithe into his house. So see, now you understand when in Malachi chapter 3 verse 8 it says to not bring God his tithe is to rob God of what is his. Now, if it was yours to give, it's your decision as to whether or not you would give it unto the Lord. But when you understand everything that you are called on in the Word of God to give belongs to God ahead of time, then you get this. That's why to not use your talent for God is robbing God. To not give of your time unto God is robbing God. To not worship God in the tithe and in the offering is robbing God. Can I give you a little advice? Don't try to live blessed robbing God. Then I read this verse. I love this verse. You're about to see why I love this verse. It's actually just part of a verse. Leviticus 3:16 says this. All the fat. All the fat belongs to the Lord. Now, there's a whole lot I could say right here, and some of y'all are already thinking it, so I'll say just a little bit of it. Y'all skinny folk, y'all lean, trim, fitness folk, just don't have as much to offer to God as some of us do. Some of us got a big offering. There's so much more I would say, but I better not. The word fat is the Hebrew word keleb. And it means fat, choicest, best part, and abundance. Look here, baby. This is the best part of me right here. The choicest part of my life. So what's he saying? Here's what he's saying. Your worship is to be your best. As Jesus said, it ought to flow out of the abundance of your heart. Nobody ought to have to beg you to worship, coerce you to worship, act like a cheerleader in front of you to get you to worship. It ought to be something that is so abundant that it flows up out of you as the best thing you have to offer is praise and honor unto God. Give God your best. The fact of your faith, the fact of his blessings, the fact of how good he is to you, the fact of your emotions, the fact of your glory and honor, the fact of your tithes and your offering, not the leftover, not the scraps, not what you have left, if you have something left by the time you get to God. Your first, your highest, your best, all the best, all the fat belongs to the Lord. Worship is about acknowledging and obeying. And as we acknowledge his goodness and obey him, we bring to God what is already his. And the Bible teaches us that bringing to God what belongs to him releases his abundance and his blessings in our life. God opens the windows of heaven and pours out a blessing you cannot contain. Anybody who's ever done that for you? Anybody want that kind of blessing? Understand, give him your best. Give him your best worship. Give him your best trust. Give him your best emotion. Give him your best in serving him in his church and in his kingdom. And he says, prove me, says the Lord, and see if I won't open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you cannot even contain. All right, let me link a couple of things to make another point. The Hebrew word terumah points out that the gift given is given to one who is higher or greater than the giver. It's not that God needs what you have to offer. It's God that God honors you by allowing you to give to him. Now, if you've read the Bible at all, you understand God's got all kinds of singers and praisers around his throne day and night forevermore singing and giving glory and honor and praise to the Lord. It's not that God needs you to praise him or he won't be praised. It's that he honors us to be able to offer what we have to one that he is, that is greater. So realize giving in worship is acknowledging that God's greater. Great is he who's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is wonderful. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God, to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art. It's realizing that God honored you to get to be here today, to give up worship and honor and praise to this glorious, indescribable, immeasurable glory of God that is in us and is with us today. He is great. Then you have the Hebrew word korban, which means to bring near. So what that word in the interpretations of bringing the offering shows you is that as the giver brings an offering in their giving, to take that offering to the one who would receive it causes you to draw near to them. Now listen, I'm going to be candid. I love our internet ministry and I love that online. Right now we got hundreds of people that are connecting together with us in ministry. You say, Pastor, some of them already turned you off. Well, some of y'all have too, so. But I'm going to tell you, there's a dynamic of worship that cannot be replicated via live stream, via a TV program, via some disconnected means of trying to connect in. There is this need to draw near. God calls us together. That's why the Word of God says when we see the day approaching, we need to make sure that we do not forsake the assembling of ourselves together. There is the touch dynamic. I talked about it in the anointing. There is the pray one for another dynamic. There is the lift up one another dynamic. There is the join together as one people and one voice under the name of the Lord that cannot be replicated from a distance. So if you can't be here, by all means, use that as an opportunity to connect in, but never let that become a substitution for just coming together in worship. So you see this realization, an offering is something that belongs to God, but something we are to bring to him in our worship, and the result of that is we get closer to God. This is good to me. Your giving in worship brings you closer to God. Well, I just wish I was closer to God, then worship him more. I think I said this Wednesday night, you got as much of God as you want. You got as much of God as you want. Well, I just tell you right now, the way I can't get, no, you got exactly as much of God as you want. Don't blame us in 2 hours out of your week for how much you don't have of God. That felt good to me. That felt good to you. Man, that felt good to me. Don't blame this choir for how much of God you do or don't have. Don't blame me or the Sunday school teacher or one of the student pastor or the children's pastor, the worship pastor. Don't blame those people for how much of God you do or don't have. It's this realization that the thing that brings you close to God is your personal worship. When you give in worship, when you give of yourself as a worshiper of God, anytime you give, anything you give, any act of giving, whether it's tithe and offering, whether it's giving by serving others in the kingdom of God, whether it's giving your time, using your talent, whether it's giving as a worshiper unto God, everything that you bring to him in giving brings you closer to him. That's why you hear him say this, draw nigh unto me, and I will draw nigh unto you. Another group of Hebrew words speaks to the reason, the cause, the motivation of the offering. And the one that you see most often in Leviticus is the word cha'aha. That's a hard one for me. And that literally is such a broad-based word, that's why it's so often used, that the word cha'aha means both the offense and the offender. And also brings into it the punishment for the offender because of the offense. It's about the action, it's about the person, and it's about the resulting punishment to the person for the action. See, that word says there is no separating the action from the person. You can't say, the devil made me do it. You thought about it and did it because you decided to do it. The devil ain't made you do it. Your husband or wife ain't made you do it. The preacher ain't made you do it. Your boss ain't made you do it. The person that's looking at their phone and the light done turn green. There is no disconnecting the action from the actor. The action from the person who is carrying out the action. That says there is no reasoning, there is no excuse, and there is no justification that works to separate someone guilty from their sin. You even read in Leviticus about those who unintentionally or unknowingly sin. And what you realize is the Bible is very clear that not knowing or understanding doesn't excuse a person or separate them from the punishment of their sin. New Testament, there's a verse that says, there was a time when God winked on ignorance, but now he calls everyone to repentance. You can't just not read the Bible and say, well, I don't understand it. I don't know what it says, as if that's going to get you by. Listen, you can get out in your car and drive out here on this street and ignore all those speed limit signs and drive any speed you want to, and sooner or later you'll run into one of those little blue light specials that will teach you that you're not understanding or acknowledging or paying attention to the law is not an excuse for breaking the law. Are you with me? And that's what makes this verse so powerful. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. He, Jesus, took on our sin so that we could receive his righteousness, his cleansing, the washing of the blood of Jesus Christ, and be made whole. It was only possible because he was willing to step into that process and say, yes, they're guilty, and yes, they're worthy of judgment, but I will take their sin for them. Praise him right now for that kind of love and mercy. Now, in this area of motivation or reason, you also see the Hebrew word nedaba, which talks about the fact that God said to them, they're to bring this as a free will or a voluntary offering. Now, realize that he's setting in place laws and commandments and processes and offerings. So you do understand that when God says something that you're supposed to do or not do, it's not a recommendation or a suggestion. God is not in a position where he needs to recommend or suggest. Because he's God, he just says it and that settles it. So he's giving us commands concerning worship. But he's saying in the midst of them, it is also important to me that you embrace what I'm calling you to do and be, and you do it voluntarily, willingly. In the New Testament, he says God loves a cheerful giver. See, you might be moved by a lot of things. You might be moved by a need that's presented. You might be moved by a ministry project that you are made aware of. You might be moved by the opportunity that in your giving you will be able to help somebody or bless somebody, that you have the opportunity to sow into the soil of a ministry that you see reaping the harvest of the kingdom of God. Or you might even be moved to give just because you see God's blessing and you're thankful to him for everything that he does for you. But it should always, your giving should always flow freely out of a desire to give to God. Worship isn't worship if it's got to be begged up out of you and you do it reluctantly so the worship pastor will quit looking at you because you ain't raising your hand. It ought to just flow up out of you freely. I don't know how you can come to the house of God and not just start automatically thinking about the goodness of God. I know some folk can't because they're so worried about what the temperature is and how bright the lights are or aren't, or the volume level of the sound on that particular Sunday, or how somebody didn't speak to them, or how this or that and the other. Some folk can come in and be sitting in church and be thinking about everything but God and about God. But when you start fixing your heart on God and thinking about how good he is, there's something in me that just automatically starts rising up. See, we ought not ever have to be begged or coerced to give. It ought to be something you got to fight back. There's this irresistible urge and uncontainable desire to give of myself to him. Leviticus 1:9 says this: then the priest will burn the entire sacrifice on the altar as a burnt offering. That's the one we're going to focus on tonight, by the way. It is a special gift, a pleasing aroma to the Lord. Now, when I read a verse like that, I get this picture of the smoke of the burnt offering. You just know you start laying animals on an offering of fire, and there is a smoke that rises up from the offering. And because of the way the language is given to us, for me, it's not just a visual. I don't even envision. Now, and I'm going to tell you, in the natural side, it wasn't a pleasant thing. If you thought the priests were the chosen ones, yeah, they were chosen. It was a slaughterhouse. It was a constant process of people walking up with rashes and lesions and sores and all kind of other stuff. And they're trying to negotiate between the law and their condition. And then there's all these goats and rams and sheep and bulls and doves and animals that are brought to the Lord to be sacrificed unto the Lord. In the natural sense, it wasn't pretty. That's why so much of it happened behind the veil. But in the spiritual sense, there is this realization that when they laid the sacrifice on the altar, the smoke of it rose up before God. You have these Hebrew words like olah that literally focuses on the smoke rising up. It's a word that talks about moving up or ascending or rising up. And you have the word isha, which talks about the fire that causes the smoke to rise up. That the fire of the sacrifice is what empowers the sacrifice to be lifted up as a sweet savor in the presence of God. And words like katar, which speaks specifically to the fragrance of the worship. What you understand is worship should be about God, unto God, and for God. It ought to be offered up in such a way that the fragrance of our worship rises up into the presence of God. And if you'll listen as I finish this up over the next little bit, you'll hear how that happens. Your worship is about God. It's for God. It's to God. This isn't a performance with a spotlight on anybody. We're not raising up performers, we're raising up worshipers. This isn't about making us famous, it's about making his name famous. This isn't about highlighting our gifts and our talents and our skills so people brag on us. It's not about how good you are at what you do. Being good doesn't make what you do worship. Being good does not make what you do worship. Being talented doesn't make your talent worship. Your worship is to be a burnt offering where the sacrifice is consumed in the fire of his presence. And the result of that consumed sacrifice is this fragrant smoke of worship that rises up before God. It's about offering what you have to give in a sacrificial act of worship to him, so that it rises up being consumed by the fire of God into his presence as a sweet savor, a pleasing aroma, a blessing to him. That's why the Bible talks about, if you do what you do to be seen doing it by people, you get all the rewards you're ever going to get in them praising you because of what you've done. If you do what you do to spotlight you, then understand that that fleeting and quickly fading moment in the spotlight is all the reward you're ever going to get. If you give to be seen, if you sing or play to show off your talent before men, if you worship or you minister to put you on display as if it is about you and what you can do and who you are, know this, that kind of ministry and worship and offering does not rise up as pleasing to God. But what's offered in the sacrifice of worship, to be consumed in the fire of the presence of a holy and a glorious God, that is the kind of offering that rises up and pleases and glorifies his name. Can I say it this way? It really is not about how good a church you think we had today. It's about how he feels about our worship. So get this picture. Exodus ends with God filling the house of worship with his glory. The smoke or cloud, some translations say, of the presence of God that fills the house of God and rises up from that place of worship. And it says to you that that cloud of the glory of God, which is a fire by night to warm them and a cloud by day to cover them, the cloud of his presence, the smoke of his glory is perpetually every day with them throughout their journey. Because you or I or nobody would make it without him. But what that also means is this. This is beautiful to me. As the smoke of their sacrifices and offerings of worship rises up, it is mingled together with the smoke of the glory of God. Their offering and his glory somewhere above them in the atmosphere is mingled together. Oh, I can say that in a way that'll bless you even more. Your worship, your sacrifice of praise, and his glory become mingled together in the fragrance of sacrificial worship that is offered. And that leads me to my last thought. Certain offerings were presented to God in specific ways. So you have a zabach offering, which meant that the animal offered was to be killed as a sacrifice. There was a death involved in the sacrifice of 1 Corinthians 15:31, Paul talks about that his rejoicing is in Christ Jesus. And then he says this, I die daily. See, we can only offer the true sacrifice of worship when we're willing to die to self and worship to him. Let everything that's about us die in the consuming fire of worship. A tenufa offering was lifted up and waved in worship before God. It was a harvest offering. There's a whole lot I don't have time to teach here. When you read about the wave offering, when the harvest would begin, at the beginning of the offering of the harvest, God said, now there were times when God said, bring a grain offering, and you can do it in different ways. You can bring it as raw grain, or you can bring it as ground up grain, or you can bake it into a loaf, just don't put any leaven in it, and bring it that way. It all represents the grain. But there was this harvest offering, and God was specific, and he said, when you go out in the fields to harvest, take the sickle and thrust it in, and everything that you gather with that one thrust, take it and bundle it up and take it immediately to the house of God and give it to the priest. And here's what the priests were to do. They took those offerings and began to wave them
in the presence of God. It was a wave offering of faith about the blessing of God that was coming. It was a harvest offering that said, I'm trusting God for a great harvest. That's why in lean years, the bundles were thin and the effect of the wind was less. But in abundant harvest seasons, there was a mighty rushing wind that filled all the house where they were sitting. So the smoke of worship affected the atmosphere with its fragrance, and the wind of worship affected the atmosphere in its stirring. And then there is the nesek, the last that I will show you, the nesek offering, which was a drink offering that was poured out. You see, something that's poured out cannot be contained or recaptured. And I'm telling you, God is trying to lead his people to the place that we're willing to reach the place of poured out worship. Not contained or constrained worship. Well, I'm going to tell this to some of you, and you'll get there, some of you, one of these days, and some folk never will. If you just break beyond that little wall right there that's stopping you from going further in worship, you'll find a place in his presence and a freedom in worship you've never known before. But you got to be willing. You got to be willing to march around that wall till it falls and then walk over it and take your claim of God's promise. You got to be willing to take that step of faith. God, if I look stupid, I'm willing to look stupid. You know what I loved about last Sunday? It's while we were worshiping. Nobody begged or coerced anybody. People just got out from where they are and came running to the altar. Some walking, some laughing, some weeping, some falling on their face, some jumping up and down in praise unto God. But what you saw is this spontaneous response to the word of God being sung in worship of God. And people who are willing to say, I'm not holding it back. I'm willing to pour out in giving in worship to you. My mind races to the scene where Jesus is having dinner at the house of a Pharisee, and a woman who everybody else in the room considered unworthy walked up to him and broke open a box of expensive perfume and poured it all on him. The house was filled. The house was filled with the fragrance of her worship. The smoke of the offering of worship. The waving wind of the offering of worship. The fragrance of pouring out the offering of worship. They all say this: that worship that is in you is potent and powerful. Your worship is like none other. And when you withhold it, you rob me of the pleasure of the fragrance of your worship consumed in my presence. So I'm calling you today. Whatever reservations or fears or hesitations you have, if you want to know the glory, if you want to walk in the deeper places of me, if you want the eyes of your understanding to be opened and the strength of your heart to be renewed, break open the box of your soul and pour out your life before me, so that I might consume it and it be pleasing unto me. And then you will know me, says the Lord. Would you acknowledge his presence? Get on your feet. Just get on your feet all over the house. Would you just lift up your hands to him in an act of worship? Just magnify him. If you're a guest with us and you wonder what just happened, we're a Spirit-filled church. We believe, as Corinthians teaches us, in the gifts of the Spirit. So we always make room for God to be God and to minister through his gifts. And that includes the gifts of tongues and interpretation, where God steps in to speak and confirm more into our lives. Just acknowledge him for a moment right there where you are. Worship him. Worship him. Worship him. Worship him. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
Opportunity for people to respond. Then if you need to slip out the door for something more important than this, you're free to go. But here's what God told me. There are people standing here that have been crying out to God for some need, some answer, some direction, some breakthrough that you have in your life. He's calling you to come before him with that as an offering of worship. Not to walk down here to cry out, God, I need you to heal me. I need you to deliver. I need you to do this. I need you to answer in this situation. God, I'm talking to you again about what I need, and there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, the Bible teaches us to be persistent in our seeking after him. There are times when he wants us to reach past, beyond the urgency, the reality of the need, and grab a hold of that thread called faith and trust, and be willing to lift the very thing that we are looking to him for up to him in an act of worship of him, to declare that he's Lord in the midst of your need. He's Lord in the midst of your sickness. He's Lord in the midst of your struggle. He's Lord in the midst of your brokenness. He's Lord in the midst of your lack. He's Lord and worthy of worship and honor and praise. So right now, in the name of Jesus, you know who you are. You've been crying out to God. You've been praying over something. And there's something stirring inside of you right now that says you need to take a moment before you walk out of here and worship Him for the very thing you've been asking Him to do in your life. Come this way right now in the name of Jesus. I'm not going to beg or coerce you. I want to give you an opportunity to reach past the need and reach up in faith and trust in Him. Right now, who are you? Come on this way. You know who you are. Take that step. Take that step and walk this way in Jesus' name. I'm lifting my need up before you in an act of worship to you. I'm lifting my brokenness up before you in an act of worship to you. I'm lifting my sickness in an act of worship before you. I'm lifting my lost children up in worship to you. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, you're a good.